Have you seen a tanker charter party form? Or do you know what are the relevant clauses which are used in tanker charter party form? In this video, we'll be covering this thing. Hey, what's up? My name is Akash from ShipScope, bringing you the best platform to learn about the commercial shipping subjects. In the Chartering 101 series, previously we started with the basics of chartering, then we slid ourselves into dry cargo chartering, and then followed by tanker chartering. In the previous lecture, we saw the world scale. In this lecture, we are going to focus upon the charter party forms and the relevant clauses related to it. If you're new here, consider subscribing it at any point of the time. Also, check out the notes and links in the description below. If you like my content, you can always go on my website and get the whole thing downloaded. The whole package consists of comprehensive lecture notes, which we are studying right now. And it even consists of the past ICS papers, SOLD ICS papers, and my own lecture notes. So it'll help you to understand the whole topic in a better way. So let's get into the topic, shall we? Hi guys, welcome to Chartering 101 by ShipScope. So in today's 11th lecture, we'll be looking into actual charter party forms. First, we'll start with the tanker voyage charter, in which we'll be looking into ASVA tank voyage. That's the charter party form, and we'll be seeing relevant clauses, some additional clauses, and finally, we'll be finishing our lecture with the tanker time charter, in which we'll be looking into Shell Time 4 and its some relevant clauses. Before we get into the tanker voyage charter, let's revise some concepts. In voyage charter party, in spot voyage charter, all the costs are borne by the ship owner, which is your fixed cost and the variable cost. It's just for one voyage, the spot charter, the voyage charter. Now we are looking into ASVA tank voyage. This is a charter party. And the part one, what does the part one consist of? Part one consists of description and position of the vessel. In this section, details such as deadweight, class, cargo capacity on a summer draft, taking into account deduction for bunkers, stores, water cone, coatings, last two cargoes, present position, and readiness to load. All this information is under this section. Second one is the lay days and cancelling. The spread of dates during which the vessel is to present at the first or load port. Voyage, name of the loading and discharging ranges of the place. The cargo, quantity may be stipulated as minimum or with a margin, say as 5% or 10%, either an owner's or charter's option, or minimum or maximum. Let's have an example. Let's say if I say minimum 80,000 metric ton or 80,000 metric ton, 5% more or less owner's option, or 80/85 metric ton minimum max at charterer's option. And we use the term called as CHOPT. The part one also consists of description of cargo, number of grades based on the gravity and sulfur content, and heating requirements if they require any. Rate billing, world skate rates agreed for various discharging rates. Lay time. The lay time which is given in the ASVA tank voyage is 72 hours. World scale term 72 hours is the lay time allowance, but again, may vary depending upon the negotiation. If something else is there, this can override this 72 hours figure. 6 hours of NOR allowed at each port. Demurrage, daily amount of liquidated damage per running hours pro rate, and commission payable by the owner. Now let's have a look in the charter party. This is the ASVA tank charter party. We have finished the part one. So this is the part one. This is the preamble, place and date. This is the part one. So this is the description of the vessel is written. Lay days, loading port, ports, discharging ports, cargo, freight rate, freight payable to, total lay time in running hours, demurrage per day, commission, the place of the general average and arbitration proceedings to be London or New York, strikeout one, special provision, and finally the signature. So this is how the part one looks like. Part two. Part two consists of warranty, voyage, cargo. The ship owner or the desperate owner confirms that the vessel is in suitable condition to safely and properly perform the contracted voyage. The ship must be seaworthy and in every way fitted for the voyage. Freight and dead freight cover the quantity and measures of the cargo,
on which the freight is paid, and their right of charters to deduct advances made to the masters or agent from the freight. Charters are liable for the dead freight. We already studied dead freight concept in our previous lectures. Berthing, pumping and mooring cover the conditions applicable to the loading and discharging place and the responsibilities for pumping cargo and mooring at sea terminals. These clauses can affect the times used as lay time. The cargo shall be pumped into the vessel at the expense and risk peril of the charterer, and shall be pumped out of the vessel at the expense of the vessel. Because when it is being discharged, it's on the vessel's behalf, and when it is being loaded, because at that time no pumps are used, the vessel has to open the valves. The cargo is taken from the shore side to the ship with the help of the manifolds, which are connected to the shorelines. Shifting from one safe berth to another. If more than one berth is used, it will be on the charterer's account and count as lay time. Cleaning rates. This states that the owner shall clean the tanks, pipes and pumps of the vessel to the satisfaction of the charterer's inspector. The cleanliness required will vary whether the intended cargo is crude oil or a clean petroleum product. Now, there are two grades, guys. As far as in tanker chartering, there is clean grade and there is a dirty grade. Dirty grades are like crude oil. The clean grades can vary from naphtha, jet even. All these oils are the white oils or the clean petroleum products. Advances. The freight payment clauses allow the charterer to deduct from the freight money advances for the ordinary disbursement at the port of loading and discharge. Now let's look into the part 2 of this charter party. The first one is warranty voyage cargo. We did study about this. The information of the freight, dead freight, name, loading and discharging ports, lay days, NOR, ask for loading and discharging, the detailed information on the clause regarding demurrage, safe berth shifting, pumping in and pumping out, hoses, mooring at sea terminals, due taxes, cargo excluded. All these clauses are regarding the Aswatang voyage charter party. Quarantine, fumigation, everything is here. Cleaning, insurance terms, bill of lading, clause paramount. These are protective clauses, Jason clause, general average, boat to blame. We did study about this clause in our dry cargo charter party as well, boat to blame collision clause. Limits of liability, war risks, deviation clause. What happens in case of deviation? Lien, agents, arbitration. There is a dispute where it's supposed to be done. Sublet, information about the sublet. Oil pollution clause. Because this, we are talking about tanker charter parties. If you read relevant case studies about Exxon Valdez, it was a big, big mess because of the oil which got spilled. That is why in tankers, oil pollution is a big thing. And finally, the bill of lading. Let's get back to the lectures. Now, what are the additional clauses? These are also known as the rider clause, which may be included in the standard contract and are subjected to negotiation. First one is the Conoco weather clause. Delays in berthing for loading and discharging and any delays after berthing which are due to weather conditions shall count as half lay time, or if on demurrage, half demurrage. If charters choose to send the ships to port notorious for delays caused by weather swells, waves or strong winds, the onset of delays follow them. Why this clause is added? Because at times, weather is something beyond control, which a charter can't help. If you send your vessel to ports like Falconara, Fiumicino, Ravenna, these are known for notorious and weather-related delays too. Because of that, you have to incorporate this clause, which will help the charterer. Especially there was this one port which we visited known as Mina Al-Ahmadi, which had low water tide restrictions. So there are issues, especially with the wind, swell, height of the waves entering the port, which prevents a vessel being held safely along the berth. The second one is the Amoco cargo retention clause. In the event that any cargo remains on board, upon completion of the discharge, charter shall have the right to deduct from the freight an amount equal to port of loading, value of such cargo plus freight due to with respect thereto, provided that the volume of the cargo remains on the boat is pumpable as determined by the independent surveyor. Crude oil has a lot of sediments and foreign matter which is not liquid suspended in the cargo which is loaded. During the voyage, this sediment settles down to the bottom of the tank, and during discharge, a certain amount of will cling to the tank so that upon completion of discharge, there will be residues within the cargo. Now, as I said, in the tanker industry, there are two grades. The first one is the black, which is the crude oil. One is the white oils. This issue comes up with the crude oil. There are a lot of sediments which do get accumulated in the internal structures. So it's very difficult to remove them. That is why we have this clause. The charter is compensated for the value and the freight payment for this cargo that has not been discharged by the owner as per the agreement. The third clause we will be looking is the cleaning clause. A typical cleaning clause is given here. Vessel shall arrive at load port with all cargo tanks, pumps and pipelines cleaned to the charterer's inspection satisfaction. Further, owners shall ensure that all the traces of sediments, tank washing and chemicals if used are removed from the tanks, pumps and pipes intended for the carriage of the designated cargo. Why do you have to clean the cargo hold is because there is a possibility of contamination, and we want the least of the charterers. There have been many instances where the disputes have rose because of mixed cargo, which just destroys the specs of the particular cargo. That is why it is recommended that you should have clean tanks. Especially if you see, again, in dirty trades, the vessels which are carrying crude oil, the big vessels, VLCCs and ULCCs, they have been carrying crude oil. So cleaning and, you know, removing the muck, which is already there in your tank, the sediments, is a bit difficult. But especially if you see the smaller vessels, the vessels which can carry the cleaner products, and there are product tankers which can carry both products, the vessels have to go through rigorous cleaning, and they have to refer to BP tank cleaning guides or Shell tank cleaning guides. These are the guides which we take into consideration before the cleaning happens. If the vessel is unclean at the cancelling deadline, charterers will retain its cancellation option until the 24 hours after the cancelling deadlines, or until 24 hours after which the first inspector first rejects the vessel, whichever is later. Clean ballast. Ballast is taken on the board to submerge the vessel. This is not a problem for the vessel fitted with the SBT. The vessels which have segregated ballast tank, it's not a big issue. But the vessels which don't, they have to make sure that the contaminant, I mean, if they take the ballast, they need to make sure that it is given back to the shore. They can't just discharge within the port area. Vessel shall arrive at load port with clean ballast. In this clause, clean ballast means ballast which is not contaminated with the oil residues and has been included in the charter parties, because many ports do not have the reception facilities for dirty ballast. Inert gas. So before entering into inert gas, I would like to tell you what inert gas system is. Inert gas system is the most important integrated system. It's mainly for oil tankers for safe operation of the ship. Inert gas is the gas which contains insufficient oxygen, normally which is around less than 8%, to suppress the combustion of the flammable hydrocarbon gas. That is why we need an IG system on board. Owners warranty that the vessel has operable and inert gas on board the vessel and system shall be operational during the duration of the charter party. Crude oil washing. Charter shall have the right to require the vessel if it's equipped to crude oil wash cargo tanks. In such a case, the allowed pumpable hours should be increased by the hours. Crude oil washing is conducted by recirculating approximately 10% of the cargo tanks through the crude oil washing gun to wash down the sides of the tank. It is easily appreciated that this lowers the net discharge rate by a certain extent. Excess pumping time will not count as lay time. Okay, so as for the pumping clause, guys, in tankers, the whole cargo can be discharged within 24 hours. That is what the owner's warranty. We will be seeing in our next slide. If we are adding crude oil washing, this will definitely increase the total pumpable time. That is where this clause is mainly added, where they will be increasing the pumping time in a lay time, which will count. The number of hours inserted is dependent upon the size of the vessel. Oil companies such as Shell have roughly around, they have introduced 0.75 hours per crude oil wash tank. Pumping clause. owner's warranty that vessel will discharge her entire cargo, as I said, within 24 hours, or they will be able to maintain the 100 PSI on the ship's rail. Any delays in pumping the cargo during the discharge for the operation condition of the ship are borne by the owner. What are the main causes in delay of pumping? The vessel boilers are unable to provide the rate, maintain the pressure required in the charter party agreement, especially if the cargo has high viscosity, residual in the drawing board, and maybe extended shipping time. Because of the vessel distance from the shore tank, there's a high back pressure. Shore tanks are much at greater elevation. The terminal provided too few hoses, or hoses are too small or deliberately closed. Shore instruction to the tanker that, sorry, reduce the pumping pressure. This called for the letter of protest from the master's behalf. How do we have a relevant document in which can prove that it was not a fault of the owner? Need to have a tanker pumping performance. Pumping logs from a vessel showing hour by hour back pressure at the manifolds and pressure at the manifold and pressure at the cargo pumps. The viscosity of the liquid being pumped. Ambient temperature need to be recorded on an hourly basis. The diameter of the pipeline length under sea. The temperature of the product as it leaves the ship and arrives at the storage tank. The height of the storage tanks above the sea level and the height of the tanks as the cargo enters. This is how the pumping log looks like. If you see, there's a ship, port, voyage name, commencement, completed, what grade it is, the details of the cargo, number of and diameters of hoses. This is how an hourly log is maintained. The next one is tanker time charter. Tanker time charter. In this, we'll be seeing the shell time for charter party. Before getting into the time charter, let's revise some concepts, guys. First thing is, the vessel is being given by the ship owner to the charter for a specific period of time, in which the charter pays a charter hire to the ship owner. The fixed costs are borne by the ship owner and the variable costs are borne by the charter. The first clause, description and condition of the vessel. Clause 1 deals with the particulars of the tanker. Part B is comprehensive list of particulars of the tankers and is a part of the charter part. Speed and consumption covered in the clause number 24. Plans of the vessel may be submitted. Shipboard personnel and duties. The charterer is hiring the ship and crew. Charter party stipulates that crew is expected to perform all voyages with utmost dispatch and provide ammunition to the charterer to deal with inefficient crew. Duty to maintain. This clause requires owners to exercise the due diligence to maintain and restore the vessel to its required condition as stated in clause number 1 and 2. Should the owners fail to maintain, the charterers have the right after 30 days of notice to put the vessel on off hire. Once in off hire, the charterers have the option to terminate the charter. If the owners have failed to demonstrate to charterers reasonable satisfaction, the exercise of the due diligence. Now let's look at the first three clauses. This is the shell time for. This is the description and the condition of the vessel. All the information regarding this. The SMS, safety management system, needs to be incorporated, which will be operated by the owners. Shipboard personnel. This is regarding their duties. Shipboard personnel should comply with all the requests for the ship owners and the charterers. Duty to maintain. This is regarding the duty to maintain. This clause number 3. Trading limits. Without amendments, charters may use the vessel in any part of the world within issued warranty limits. Lay days cancelling. The charters have the right to cancel if the vessel does not arrive at the delivery point by the cancelling time and date. Charters may be entitled to cancel if the vessel does not present in the condition required by the charter party. For example, in every way fitted for the cargo service. It is customary for the vessel to be inspected prior to the delivery of the charterer to ensure that she complies with what is agreed in the charterer and what the charterer had expected of the vessel. Some charter parties allow the owner time to rectify any faults while list. Others give the charterer the right to cancel the charter party without any claims against them. Owners to provide is given in the clause number 6. What all things will owners will provide, which consists of provision, wages, seater of master, officers, crew, engineers of the vessel, store, water, dry docking, all these things will be provided by the owners. What does the charterers provide? In shell time 4, specified what charterers shall provide and pay for while this vessel is on hire. Example about bunkers, loading, unloading costs, port charges, canal, etc. All the variable costs. Ladies and cancelling, as I said, the owners to provide, this is the clause which highlights what all things owners should provide. And number 7, clause highlights what all charterers are supposed to provide. Clause 89, rate of hire and payment of hire. Hire can be described as a financial payment to the owners for leasing the manned and equipped vessel to the charterers. Essentially, hire shall be paid from the moment of the ship is delivered to the charterer until she has been re-delivered to the owners on termination of the charter period. The charterers pay hire in advance and can only recover hire in respect of idle time if he can show that the vessel was lost for one casual specified or one of the causes specified in off-hire clauses. However, if the vessel stops at sea, a deduction of hire could occur through the performance clause as per number 24. The payment of hire must be made in immediately available funds, meaning that the money must be in the owner's account, free for his use, otherwise it is not deemed paid. Should the charterers be in default by paying either too late or too little, the ship owner would be entitled to cancel the charter. If the payment is due on non-banking days, hire must be made the previous day. The clause in 8 and 9, as we discussed, is this. The clause number 10 is space available to charterers. 11 focusing on segregated ballast. Instruction and logs in number 12. The 13th clause focuses on bill of lading. Clause number 14 is conduct of vessel's personals. As I said, if the charterer complains of any conduct of the master or any of the officers or crew, owner shall immediately investigate this complaint. If the complaint proves to be well-founded, owners shall, without delay, make a change in the appointments. And owner shall, in any event, communicate the results of their investigation to charterers as soon as possible. Bunkers at delivery and redelivery. Stevedores, pilots, tugs, supernumeraries. These are supercargoes. These are the representatives sent from the charterer on the ship. Subletting the vessel. Final voyage. Final voyage. Clause number 19. Owners are obliged to take the ship if charterers redeliver earlier. However, they are entitled to full freight, either from the alternative employment or from original charterers. When charterers are planning the last voyage for the vessel, they need to take into consideration where and when she has to be delivered under the agreement. The failure is excused by exception clause. A failure to redeliver in accordance with the provision in the charter is a breach of contract, which entitles the owner to claim damages. Overlap. If the redelivery is after the agreed date, the owner is entitled to claim for the overlap period, the difference between the charter rate and the market rate of hire if hire. Underlap. However, if the redelivery is before the agreed date, the owner is entitled to claim the charter rate for the underlap period, even if the market rate is less than the charter rate. So these are the information regarding the final voyage. Just have a look, have a read, guys. Okay, I've already given you the gist. Loss of vessel. Should the vessel be lost, the charter shall terminate hire. This is regarding if he loses his vessel. Off hire. This 21, clause number 21, specifically focusing on what all events it is subjected to off hire. Then we have periodical dry docking. We have ship's inspection. This is the performance clause, in which owner says that in laden condition, It will consume this amount of fuel oil with what speed, and these are the DU consumption. Similarly, in ballast condition, it will give this amount of speed with this amount of consumption in fuel oil and this amount of consumption in the diesel oil. Salvage or fire clauses. It is certain, clearly defined set of circumstances a vessel engaged under a time charter party can be off-hired. An off-hire event is an event which has deprived the charter the use of the ship. Off-hire counts as part of the charter period. As hire is paid in advance, any recoveries that may become due can only be made by the deduction of subsequent month's hire payment. Even when it is known that the vessel will be off-hire at the due date for payment, hire must be paid in full. Off-hire clauses have a threshold, say 3 years, and only when it is exceeded, the vessel is put on off-hire. When the time loss exceeds the threshold limit, the vessel is off-hire from the commencement of the delay. Withdrawal. All tanker charters contain a withdrawal clause. This is important protection for the owner, enabling him to regain control of his ship if the hire money is not paid in time. Shell time for allows 7 days grace period. The owner's right to withdraw continues throughout the charter party and centers around the non-payment of hire, late payment or part of the payment hire. Such a right to withdraw is only available if express reserved. The default committed cannot be raised or remedied by the effecting a late payment unless, of course, the owners agreed a particular late payment. And finally, performance clause. The sea performance will be warranted by the owner in terms of speed and bunker consumption, and most tankers charter now have detailed and very tight performance clause. Although in some charters, the performance will be qualified by about, let's say about meaning 5% bunker consumption or 0.5 knots in speed. The charters will have the right to reduce the higher rate or deduct from higher the amount of any performance penalties or pay any saving made to the owners. These performance clauses may include pumping rates and other aspects of the port performance, but their most significant features is the speed and bunker consumption. So this is the shell time 4. We already spoke about the 24 clause number 24, the clause on salvage, lien, exceptions, injurious cargoes, what are the bunker grades to be carried, laying up, requisition, outbreak of war, war risks, boat to be named, collision clause. Again, these are the protective clauses here. And finally, we have laws and litigation, arbitration, and with this, the finally we seal off the charter party with the signature of the owner and signature of the charter. With this, we finish off the lecture number 11.
Question of the day. I would like you guys to reread the charter party form. If you have any queries, let me know in the comment section below. If you like the video, hit the like button. And guys, always remember, one of the most important tips and feedbacks come from you guys. So feel free to connect me on LinkedIn. Thanks for checking out the video. Subscribe if you haven't already. In the next lecture, we'll be seeing the lay time regarding tankers. Until next time, ShipScope is bringing you the best platform to learn about the commercial shipping subjects. Keep on learning it, and we will talk soon.